This is somebody, right?
Okay,
Marsha?
I think, Ms. Dixon, if you can check, I believe we are on in a minute. I think
I haven't. Did you tag us?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah, it's good now. You're good. Hold on.
It's good. Yay. Okay, you guys, like and share on your pages. We are up and running. It's
you mean awesome. Add to your timeline, add to their timeline.
Oh, yeah, add it to your timeline, everybody. Like, share, add to your timeline. It's on. We are on and popping. Good evening, everybody. Good evening, good evening, good evening. Y'all let me know when y'all ready.
Let's roll.
Y'all ready?
Yep, let's go. Let's do it.
All right, let's get it done.
Yes, sir.
All right, I got to turn this off, y'all. Hold on a second. I need to make sure this is off. Okay, it's off. All right. Okay. All right, we good to go. All right, everybody, welcome to this week's edition of The Hot Seat. I am your hostess, Miss Coffee Brown, in the building. My co-host, honored co-host, is in the building with us, Mr. Charles Dixon. Mr. Dixon, how you doing, sir?
I'm doing well, and yourself?
Doing incredible. We got Toneil Jackson in the building with us this evening. Robert Lee.
How you doing, ma'am?
Batman in the building. What's up, Toneil? What's going on? You ready to get down tonight? You ready?
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's two on three, so we gotta drink together.
I don't think it's gonna be no problem. So I think we're gonna out. I think we can.
We all know Toneil is always ready to fight, so get ready.
If I need to, you know, that's such a bad word. I don't fight. Intellectually, that's all it is.
All right, you guys, we're gonna say a word of prayer real quick, and we're gonna go ahead and get started. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for this opportunity to share with your incredible people. We do not take for granted each and every week these great people that you have created, our panelists, and Father, the ideas and thoughts that you place in our mind to share with your believers, Lord, we want to assist them and help them with their relationships, Father. Help us to take the information and utilize it so we can be better stewards over our loves that are in our life. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's get it in. Bruce, what's up?
Ain't nothing.
Bruce, I got a question. Why is it? I got a question because I've been wanting to ask this for like 2 weeks. Why is it that men say that they don't know who they're loving when we have like weave and stuff like that? Weave, body shapers, all that kind of stuff. Why do men say they don't know makeup, anything that's not how you were naturally, you know, came out of your mother's womb? Why do men say it like it's like they just have no clue as to who the woman is behind the enhancements? Why is it like that?
Okay. You're asking me that?
I'm asking you.
Because, oh boy. Oh,
here we go.
Let's go.
Because we don't know how much esteem you attach to each of those things.
Mm.
To your eyelashes.
Ooh, that's good.
To your hair weave.
That's good.
And all other stuff that's not real. We don't know how much esteem y'all attach to it.
Mm.
So stripping you down to your bare self, we get the real you.
Ooh.
Mm-hmm. That's it.
You can actually add some esteem when you put on that other stuff.
So do you think that if it's, okay, so based on what you just said, what you're saying is underneath all of the enhancements is where the true person lies. Dig this. Mm-hmm. What if there is no identity of the canvas that's underneath all that stuff?
It has to be.
Mm-hmm.
Pause. It has to be.
Okay. And even Pause if it's not... And even if it's not good, that it is what it is.
It is what it is.
Okay. Somebody's phone is buzzing.
Somebody's buzzing or vibrate. Somebody's on vibrate.
Yeah, buzzing. Somebody's buzzing.
The more is enhanced.
Mm-hmm.
The more that shell is enhanced, the more we know that, or the more we should know, that at its foundation, something is missing. Mm. And that's my humble opinion.
Okay, so Charles, get on that. When he said the more it's enhanced, what does that mean? Define
what he's trying to say is the more enhanced, the more apparent the level of layers there are to her.
Mm-hmm. Come on, Charles.
And the layers are, I mean, let's just be real. Just we all know enhancements, if you do them regularly enough and consistent enough, we take on the persona of it being real. So yes. Thus now you are married to the fact of never really disrobing. Like I know people I've dated over the past, they always look date ready 24/7. I've never seen them behind the door, what goes on in the bathroom, all these things. It's just 24/7, like made up, like they come from the shop. When you don't wake up from the shop.
How you date ready like that?
There are some people that are committed to you seeing them the way they want you to see them. So they always prepare themselves that way.
Your sound gone, Mr. Dixon. You turned the sound off. Your sound is gone. Your sound.
Can't hear you.
Can't hear you, Charles.
Can't hear you, Charles? Charles.
Sound.
It sounds like he got some really good points, too. It seemed like.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we got you now. Right, Tamir? I'm over here trying to take notes.
Something says about network issues. Okay, so where did I stop at? I said pretty much
you were talking about how she's always ready.
Yes, if they're always ready and they never really really disrobe to show you who they are organically, they're kind of forcing you to accept the now. Now we know beneath all of that is something else. Now here's another important fact, and it may sound like a joke, but this is for real. Sometimes a woman can be organically cute in her face and the hair and all those other things will enhance it. But if her hair is the extreme opposite length of that hair, her facial appearance can make a total different look with that hair off. It really does make a different look. I've seen women, when you catch them off the hair, it's like another person. So my point is, give the man the chance to be comfortable with that person, the showgirl, whoever you want to be, but let us see the organic part first.
Okay, so I got another question.
Okay.
With that as an expectation. So I'm going to let Robert answer this one. With that being an expectation, let y'all see the organic her, but you found her with the enhancements. How does that play out? Well, of course,
as a man, I like your beauty. I see the enhancements on you.
Right.
But I'm still want to know the woman. Who are you without it? Because a lot of times, ladies, y'all say it. I can't go out because my nails ain't done. I can't go to the store without my makeup. I got to do this. I got to do that. I need to see you at your nakedness, who you really are. Because a lot of times, see, like we said, the hair, the nails, the earrings, the lip gloss, the lipstick, and this, that, another. Why are you ashamed of the real you without the enhancement? Because, see, you have become the enhancement. You feel like you are nothing without the enhancement. Let me see you. Put it like this here. Let me see you in the morning. Who are you in the morning? That's what I need to know beyond. I need to know the woman that wakes up in the morning that might have a blotch here, that might have a blackhead on the nose, that might have a little discoloration up under the neck.
That's the real person. The thing about women,
if a man cannot love you without your enhancement, but he only wants you for your enhancement, just like what we was talking about in part one. I don't want you. I want to rub the vessel. I don't want to taste the wine. Because the wine is the discoloration. The wine is, like I said, no good hair, bad hair, but it's the kinky hair. It's the it's the little ponytail that comes in the back. That's you. And if I can love you at that stage, and some women get offended by men, how could you love me? How could you care about me? Look at me. It's you.
This year.
That's my answer. Yeah. So Neil, let's flip the script on, because they done went all in. Robert been talking about the blotches and all that, and lips and, you know, Charles over there saying that, man, if your hair is up, if your hair short as mine, but your weave is down to your behind, that's a problem. It's situation and whatnot. And then Bruce said the people just got some, you know, they hiding. Pause. You know how Bruce said the pause. You know, he put pause on it twice. He paused it twice today. So let's flip the script.
Right.
When on the other side of the coin, and the guy got all the big toys and the big things, right?
Okay.
But you have no kind of conversation. You can't talk to him about nothing behind closed doors. Everything about him is superficial, and everything you see is external. And he has the big vocabulary. He studied every word in the vocabulary. He knows Webster's dictionary like the back of his hand. Nonetheless, if there was some validity to a conversation, a commune with him outside of this superficial big car, big house, all that, there's nothing there. It's just an empty shell. How does it look from a woman looking at a man with the same exact issues?
You know what? I think, first of this, listening to these three gentlemen, it is really mind-blowing to me, and I'm going to tell you why. Because even though I know it's said that women don't do what they do for men, they do it for other women, but I would guarantee you a lot of women, all of these enhancements we're talking about, they put them on because men put out there that this is what we want our women to look like, because you have a lot of women who will go natural. Like I tell people all the time, I'm very low to no maintenance, and I'm proud about that fact. Like that's not something that I really, you know, am big about, because I feel like that it's supposed to be about who you are intellectually, who you are as a person. But a lot of the women are doing what they're doing because they call themselves trying to capture this man or captivate his attention or what have you. But to answer your question, Coffee, I think, like, for me, I am one, and we talked about this some weeks ago, I am one who I am intellectually stimulated. So, like, I can talk to somebody and, you know, I don't have to see you to be, for you to appeal to me. You see what I'm saying? And I think that sometimes you have so many people who they are stimulated by what their eyes see as opposed to what their heart sees, or what their eyes see as opposed to what they hear. Because at the end of the day, my grandmother used to always say, all of that stuff, all the external stuff, it will fade away. And if you cannot have a conversation with somebody, then you're going to be lost, because what else really is it to keep you going? Because the conversation can really turn a plethora of things around. You can be creative and come up with some things. So when you have these guys who got, you know, they feel like because they got a pocket full of money, because they got the best cars, because they got this and that, they're being just as superficial with all of their enhancements as well. It's just not physical enhancements, but it's still enhancements all the same.
Right. So, it's still physical. It's still physical because it's still tangible. It's just not attached. Well, actually, you still got the suits. You still got the watches and the all. I mean, guys can dance it up too. They can go and get their Just for Men Ministries because they don't want to be gray. Let me go ahead and just, you know, make sure I put on all this. I mean, I have seen dudes, and being a former cosmetologist, a guy could never come to me and tell me that's his beard. And I just look at him, I'm like, dude, that ain't yours, though. I've been around the hair industry for 30-some years. That is not your hair tonight, okay? So they have and then they go get their line all defined at the barbershop, make sure everything is intact. But then there's no validity to who they are outside of that. Like today, a client came in our office. I mean, dude was cleaner than a board of health. Yet when he opened his mouth, you could tell all the women in the room was like, wow. It was almost like all the women were like disappointed. Because the minute he opened his mouth, everything he said was about himself. Everything. Yeah, I work here. I do this. I got that. I got this. I got that. And when he left, all of us just looked at each other like, he played too much.
When you see men like that, those are
yourself.
Right.
When you see men like that, mm-hmm. just like we as people, just people in general, when you see a man like that's a damaged man. He has no, like we said, mm-hmm. there's nothing else to him. So mm-hmm. I have to have these enhancements because if you try to sit me down and have a conversation with me, I have nothing to talk about. I can't man, go beyond the, I can't go beyond the Bugatti. I can't go beyond the master's degree. I can't go beyond the MBA. I can't go beyond the PhD. I can't have a common sense conversation. You see what I'm saying? It's even to the level, I would even say this sometimes, we speaking about men, that's how I do mine, I keep mine on balance. Getting on brothers a lot of times. A lot of times, you can hear brothers with the Bible up under their home and be able to quote scripture, but they're not men of God. But they use that as a facade because a lot of women are
Robert, I'm going to throw something at you.
No, they hide it in God. They hide it in God. So for me to get to those women to bring them out or to use them, I got to put on the airs that I am a man of God.
Yeah.
And a lot of times women fall for that persona because like I said again, when that, put the Bible down and let's have a conversation, I can talk to you and still be speaking scripture, but I don't have to use scripture. Mm-hmm. And that's how a lot of times we put these shells, these personas and the fakeness on, and we can't keep up with it. That's how a lot of times we don't want to be vulnerable because we don't want to take our mask off. When we come with the representative, this is our representative. Now let's take the mask off. Mm-hmm. Let's ask hard questions. Mm-hmm. Let's get to know each other. So that's one of the number one issues why we can't, because nobody's being real with each other. Everybody's trying to hide their pain. Everybody's trying to hide their traumas.
Right.
You know, you don't want to speak to that because if we speak to our traumas, you may not like me. You may not be able to deal with me. So what we end up doing, we hide our traumas, but we attract those with trauma. We are dating trauma.
Yeah.
We only attracted to people that are able to give us our trauma back. Not able to give us healing or help us through our healing.
Right.
Mr. Dixon.
So real quick, whose phone is vibrating? Because this kind of, it's kids keep
going. That's what I'm trying to get. Let me just.
Okay, it's somebody's phone. You got an iPad or something?
Oh, yeah, let me see.
I know what it is. It's the comments. As they're commenting, it's buzzing on the phone. That's what
it is. Yeah, you're going to have to put it on silent.
It's buzzing,
You're going to have to put it on silent. Yeah. Okay, when you brought up,
we thank you to everybody that's commenting, though.
I know, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Robert, when you just brought up, you brought up something that I kind of didn't want to get into, but I'm gonna get into it because you brought it up, and I'm gonna blame it on you. So, when you made the comment about the man of God syndrome that a lot of women have attachments to. Where does that stem from? Because it's a syndrome. It really is. It's a symptom of something greater. But where did it come from? Where's it coming from, Bruce?
It comes from you guys wanting men to be men of God. That's where it's coming from.
What does that mean, though? That's the whole point. The syndrome is a facade. That's not really, what does it mean to be a man of God?
I beg to differ. I don't really, I'm going to be honest with you, having been raised in church and been there, done that. Let me just say this. When a woman tells me she really, really want a man of God, I'm going to question you because I'm going to tell you there are some things a man of God ain't going to do with you. So do you really want a man of God? And so here's the other part of it. A lot of times what women want is for you to be God respectful, God conscious, maybe go to church when I have an event or maybe on Sunday we can look cute as a family and go to church, but don't come home with the God-led mentality of running this home or advising me. Because if you are really a man of God, you're going to put on the cloak. And there, if you're not married, there are some things you're gonna say like, you like, listen, I know you fine, sister, you look good, but right now we don't need to do that. Now we know our flesh, Bruce. We're gonna be like, all right, I want to go ahead and do you looking sexy tonight. But really, if that man of God puts on his rightful cloak, he's going to reject you. Now, are you ready for that man of God? And I see a lot of people, they want to say that, but if we're honest, we want to live out our lasciviousness. We want to do all those things and still be safe and still call ourselves good people, but we don't really want to deny ourselves of anything. So that's why I say I don't really think you really want a man of God. You want someone that is respectful, because a lot of men out here, they'll tell you, I ain't going to that pastor church. Ain't taking my money. Nah, I ain't paying nobody no tithes. Y'all go ahead and be in that cult. So women don't want men like that. They want the man that's going to at least say, okay, baby, I'll put on a suit and go with you to church on Sunday. And then go back down in the basement, smoke his weed, and drink his drink on football Sunday. So that's just
facts. What it is. Did he start?
Facts.
That's what we do.
Did you have to bring out some weed, Charles?
The exchange is, you go
don't
to church,
leave.
And when we come home, I'm going to leave you alone. You go down there and drink and smoke with your friends, but you already did your duty by going to church, so thank you. Go ahead on to your life now. All everybody at church see that my man is compliant. You know what I'm saying?
That's not, okay. Evidently, definitions have not, there's no definitions, evidently, because based on all that you just said, that's not a man of God. That's a man, that's a human, period. Not a man of any kind of, under any type of authority, as far as from a spiritual perspective, if he's just doing him. That's what it sounds like to me. And the female is, like I said, the syndrome, the female is trapped by the idea of, oh, he went to a building. That doesn't make him godly in any kind of capacity. So it's a syndrome. It's not a real thing. Yes. It's not true. It's just
but we live in a day and age where a lot of men aren't stepping nowhere near the church. So if a guy can, a woman can get a man to commit to that, she happy. Because a lot of these guys, I mean, look, a lot of the stuff happened at church, all the effeminate stuff, all that, real dudes don't really want no part of it. That's just what it is. They standing back and they not going. And so the women are like, will you go? And if he said, yeah, I'll go, they happy. That's it.
Well, I'm going to the comments. We got 995. Well,
go ahead on to the comments.
It's going off. Okay. So
go ahead.
Marva King, I can't even get back to the front of it because there's so many of them. Marva King said, good point. Carrie said, right, Robert. Elisa says, Elisa Yvette says, low self-esteem. Carrie said, amen to the 100 power, Robert. Fine as wine said, that's predatory behavior. Deborah Bowie Brown says, enhancements are fine. We all like them, but it shouldn't be something that you depend on. You shouldn't need makeup to go to a football game. You should be able to throw on a baseball cap, gym shoes, no makeup, and still look cute. And Katonia says, oh, my, they quote a scripture, but not a man of God, so real. Loretta Johnson says, true. Lisa Thomas says, you're saying a mouthful, 100% truth. Be real in all areas, not just the visual and tangibles, Carrie said. Deborah said, facts, trauma people attract trauma people. Katonia said, good stuff, everybody's trying to hide their trauma. Darren said, women want men of God. Carrie said, exactly, Bruce. Carrie also said, women really don't want a preacher for a husband on purpose if they know what they're asking for. Mm-hmm. And Mrs. Boyer said, wow. Marva said, yes, at Charles, that's so true. And Carrie said, good point, Charles. And Katoni said, come on, Charles, say it, make it plain, sir. Certain things a man of God is not going to do. Kimberly Adiva said, enhancements for both men and women are only as valuable as the people they attract. People that use enhancements only do so because someone is attracted to them. The whole purpose is to attract attention, and so it does. Wow. And so it does for those that like it. Very, very true. That, I think that sums it up in a nutshell. If you're doing it to get attention from somewhere, I don't know, and most likely it's not self-seeking attention, it's external attention. Maybe it's and then the societal norms. And I said something about this a few days ago. I said, yeah, you can't serve God and cat. That's what I said.
And who?
And cat.
C-A-T. Oh, or, okay.
Yeah, or the baseball bat. You know, you can't serve God and cat and the baseball bat. But what Kimberly Adiva said was really very true, because I think a lot of this has to do with the societal norms, the exposures that we have now. We used to see women, and Tonil, I know you can back me on this. When we were younger, we saw women without a whole bunch of enhancements. It wasn't, if you saw a woman with mm-hmm. enhancements, she stood out. Yeah. That wasn't the norm. Mm-hmm. So in our era, mm-hmm. you didn't see women with all the extras and all those bits and pieces and all this other kind of stuff. They mm-hmm. were as they were. So if you saw a woman and she had all the extras, then you look at her sideways like, what's going on with Sally over the month? Ooh, okay. She stuck out. Now, if you're the opposite, you stick out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's interesting how the times have totally changed on how we actually view ourselves. And that's another thing. I think the reality TV has subjected mm-hmm. us to a lot of false hopes and identities and all those type of things. And like going back, this is just a spinoff from last week, guys, with the lifestyle. So we talked about how this week we're talking about basically how we're loving on each other. How are we dealing with each other from the love perspective? Do we even know what love really looks like when you're dealing with your person on an intimate level? If they're trapped in this facade and this reality TV stuff, like I ask people, you know, what's your favorite television show? And when they tell me reality TV, I just look at them and I don't say anything. But I think to myself, if that's your favorite television show, that's a problem.
Mm-hmm.
Your energy, you're buying into that philosophy and saying that what they're saying or what they're doing is something real within your mind, that is some kind of truth to it. It's no validity to that stuff. That's chaos and confusion. Mm. I mean, who wants to be with somebody gonna beat their brains out, and then next week he's sleeping with two of your friends, and then the week after that you going back to him because you don't want to give him up, so you figure you're gonna stay there. That's going to keep him with you, and you know full well he didn't sleep with two of your friends. That's dysfunction and sadness. That's crazy.
But see, Coffee, the reason why it's a lot of people's favorite shows, low-key, if we're going to be real truthful, it's because that's the life that they live in. That's mm-hmm. what they're going through. So a lot of times people love being able to see that they're not the only person that's going through a situation. And then the fact that it's popular, the fact that it's on TV as well. So now it's like, oh, so this must really not be that twisted. I was just talking to a girlfriend of mine the other day, and we were kind of talking something similar to this. Like, a lot of women want kind of what Charles alluded to. You want either that church man, because we've seen before how you don't want a man that other people don't want, right?
Right.
So
right.
That automatically then means that you want the man that everybody do want. So you want the pastor or the musician or the athlete or, you know, that person that's in that type of position, a six-figure job, whatever. Mm-hmm. But the fact of the matter is that you don't really know what you're getting into when you get it, because 9 times out of 10, if you like them, so do somebody else, and they don't really feel the need, unless it's just ingrained in them. They don't have to be monogamous. They don't have to be, you know, faithful to you, because they got all of these different options. And so what we do is we demean ourselves by saying, okay, well, it's fine. Have me, her, and her too, and it's mm-hmm. okay. And then a lot of times the people all know each other. They all know mm-hmm. that this is your girlfriend, mm-hmm. and this is your woman, and this is your side chick, and this is your this person, this is your that person, and they find a way to be okay with it. So when you got shows like the reality TV shows, what it does is just makes them feel better about their own situation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, what that also is saying, Toniel, is when it gets to that point where people are okay with things, we have moved into a society now where people are just, it's just like this. Look, I know you're doing this, that, and the other, but just respect me. Don't, you know, now we put mm-hmm. these parameters of respect. As long as I don't want to see you I don't want to see you out. And if you don't let her come at me, and don't let her try to embarrass me. Give me my respect. Mm-hmm. And you can go on and do whatever you do until you get back to me. That's the mentality that we live in.
But that is not, how could that be even?
But go ahead, Rob.
It's the society. Yeah. We have actually now, like I tell people when I talk to them, we are too okay with stuff.
Yeah.
In other words, what I'm saying is this. Yeah. We now, black women believe that men gonna cheat. So now that is the narrative. They actually believe it. So I'm going to deal with, I accept now in society that I'm going to be an option.
Yes.
Okay. Now, men know that they have several options.
Options,
so
yeah.
There is no need for me to be a man of any kind of character, any kind of quality, of any kind of substance, because let me explain why. The two women that we have on here, not, I'm just using you, but I don't mean this is you. A lot of times, as attractive as these two women are, I'm broke. I have a baby by her, and I have a baby by her. And I ain't got nothing going on. Why? Because it is accepted. See, we as we have made it okay for men to not be of any substance. We also have made it okay for women to have no substance. You are, like we said, the enhancement. You are not a real woman unless you have the eyelashes. You're not real unless you have the weed. And even now it's turning to this way. You ain't even real if you ain't just wearing lip gloss and got natural hair.
Wow.
Because even now there is a war between women, natural hair, and weed. But you're still women. You're still, that doesn't mean because you got weave in your hair, you a better woman, or because you are natural, that means you are a true black woman. That don't mean that. Because the person inward.
Internally, because internally.
You can have the natural hair and still have a bad attitude, and the woman over here with the eyelashes and the weave could be the sweetest thing
nice.
On the planet.
Yeah, it'd be nice.
See what I'm saying? So, and like I said again, right now, the number one woman between the ages of 18 and 35 that is Googled for lifestyle, relationship, and how to do business is Carly B. Now, she has surpassed. She has surpassed Amber Rose. She has surpassed Amber Rose. The number one woman between the ages of 18 and 35 is Carly B. That's why she women flock to her. But how do you handle men? But you are mimicking a female that has admitted that she drugged and robbed men.
Right.
She swung around a pole. But look at me now.
I've evolved. Yeah.
Trick some men.
Right.
Degrade yourself. You'll get you one day, and just like my sister said, a lot of people are actually living the same lifestyle at our level, at the,
absolutely.
I would say, most comfortable, whatever level, we still doing the same thing that they doing. They doing threesomes, we doing threesomes.
Yeah. That's it.
We got side chicks, they got side
chicks. We got side chicks, that's it.
You know what I'm saying? I'm a multi-millionaire, and I got 9 children. I'm a dude working at McDonald's. I got 9 children.
Wow, I can relate.
I got a Bugatti, and I got women throwing tea and water in each other's face. I'm down here working as a busboy, but my gal in the neighborhood, they pulling weave out of each other's head. We living the same life.
Same life, yeah.
We just don't have no standards anymore.
Right, that's true.
We just don't have the standards. We just don't.
That's heavy. And so with that, it brings me to the thought of... How are we even going to begin the journey to even be able to identify love in any kind of capacity if this is how we're existing? I mean, what you said is very true, because the same rules of the game apply when we see on television where the child support order was $30,000 a month versus $30 a month. It's still a child support order. And so, you know, just the concept of that, and even when it's funny when you mention the natural, just from personal experience, people say, oh, I love your natural hair. And I say, my hair really isn't natural. And they say, what you mean, Coffee? I said, you see all this color, honey? My hair is white underneath all this color. I ain't going white right now. My hair is premature gray, and I put as much color as I can stand in here. And that's not natural. Natural is my gray hair that's underneath here.
It ain't natural you.
So I
let's
probably
see the natural you.
You said let's see the natural you.
Come on, let the color go.
No, I ain't letting no color go. You can let your color go, but I'm letting mine go on tonight, honey. I'm gonna put this color. I'm gonna be in this blonde ministry, and if I feel the red spirit, I will go back to the red spirit. But I promise you, I won't be in the skin.
Come on.
I ain't gonna do that.
Not so, P. Coffee.
Not at no 40. Yes, sir.
Let me lend a suggestion, I think, of of the start of resolve. And I think as you all were talking, I was thinking about something. So believe it or not, as much as we can admire, you know, all the augmenting and all of the turn up physically and all those things, really men, whether women know it or not, it creates a subliminal wedge between us and you. Because now we feel like we are, it's almost like we're going to a 25-cent peep show. You on the other side of the glass and we over here. We're dealing with you, but you're holding us like we're visiting you in prison. It's like you over there, we over here, but we can see you, but we can I really get to you? And think about it. It doesn't matter. There's not a woman on the planet. I don't care if she got fake this, that, and the other hair, lashes. All women, when it comes to a man, they all want you to keep it 100 and show me you. Show me your heart. Tell me your problems. So for us, we want you all to disrobe as the same way you want us to forthcome with who we are and be clear and trust in you. That's what it is.
So listen, Dr. Dixon, I'll tell you what, I'm going to let my person see me put the color in my head so he can see it white. How about that?
No, I'm not saying that, but I'm just saying, no, I'm saying that's the equivalent.
I'm being silly.
What we are saying, we want to feel like, because to us in this day and time, if we're going to be real, if in this day and time, if any man is honest with himself, a lot of women look like you see on Fred Flintstone movie back in the day, you see all this. It looked like assembly line. Women all on assembly line looking the same weave,
wait, hold on,
same lashes,
hold on,
the same color rimming. And all looks like an assembly line. I'm being straight. Listen, we are looking for you to step off the line and dare to be different and say, look, this is me, but I still love you. Bam. Be who you are and come straight out. And so with us, that will say, okay, she is bearing all to me. So let me bear all to her. I'm telling you what it is. All right.
Y'all got to get out
the picture. Did you say the assembly line? I'm just trying to understand, Mr. Dixon.
That's what it looks like.
A lot of women are afraid to be pick-me's.
Correct.
You hear this term called pick-me's. Women go at each other talking about you a pick-me. In other words, you standing out. You're not rawing the sisterhood. You don't stand out where a man can look and say, she's unusual.
Yeah.
She's not like others. But women turn around when she stands out. Girl, get back in line. You are acting like a pick-me. You only saying, you only doing to attract this man or get the attention of men. Well, I tell those women all the time, they call women pick-me. Don't you want some attention? Mm. Don't you want a man to look at you? You really getting ignored because everybody got red hair. Everybody got eyelashes. Everybody wearing that. Now you say, how can we start on this journey? One of the things that ladies have to understand is we go the way that you go.
Yeah.
In other words, what I'm saying is this.
Yeah.
If I don't have to work and I can lay in your house, I can have children with you. I don't have to marry you. I don't have to drive. I'm going to do what I have to do, the minimal, to get with you.
I'm allowed to do.
But women say, I want the man to work. I want the man to have a vision. I want the man to have a goal. But the dude that's sitting on your couch, like I was on vacation, most of the men that sit on your couch, you can't turn. But baby, when you off work? When is your next vacation? What's your 401k look like? Most of the dudes that are sitting on your couch is working seasonal work, temporary work, or ain't working. But y'all say that's okay because you talk about, well, everybody have a hard time. No, ladies, we go by what you do. If we don't have to have very much of a standard to get you, we ain't gonna raise our standards up. If women would start turning men down with foolishness, enough of y'all do that, men will change. Well, look, man, I got
You'll
to have
get together.
A job.
You'll get together.
I got to get it together because most of the women, I done came across 5 women, and I done told them, look, I work for temporary service.
Right.
I work for a temporary service. No, baby, I can't. I like you. You cute. You fine. You smell good. But you know what? When you get a full-time job, come back and holler at me. And when he go through those 5 women, by the time he gets to number 6, He got a part-time job. He ain't working at Tipware Center no more.
Yeah, that's it.
Women, y'all got to. I'm telling you, you are what we go by. Like I keep telling women, if you call yourself a queen, stand as one. Get away. When I walk past, you talking about, I'm a queen. Look at me. Baby, you down there with the peasants. I don't see a queen.
Wow. Tell them.
May the Lord watch.
You want to see me be as a king?
Yeah.
Be as a king.
I hear what you're saying, Robert, but I feel like this is something that concerns me, because it seems to me like we're taking the responsibility off ourselves and saying it's you, it's your fault, it's your responsibility, when in fact it's all of our responsibility to be accountable for our own behavior. There's a lot of men who are doing enhancements. They're getting penile implants. They're doing all kind of stuff, wearing weaves and everything else to try to make themselves look a certain way. And decided, and they're trying to sell a woman a dream and a vision that's never going to come to pass. So a lot, the guy that does have the job and everything else, he's still selling the woman a vision that's never going to come to pass. So there's still a lot of deception going on. And I feel like we're still trying to play this blame game, saying, okay, it's the women that need to do it. It's the men. But if everyone just was responsible for their behavior, it's everybody's responsibility. If we stop saying that it's this sex or that sex, and we say, you know what, all of us need to work on learning how to first love ourselves so we can love our neighbor as ourselves.
Right. So when I said blame, go ahead, Tom.
No, I was just going to pee coffee. I think what he was saying, if you really listen to what he said, it may sound daunting to the female ear, but really he's paying y'all a compliment. And what he is saying is, wherever the woman goes, so does the culture. And he's trying to say women hold so much power that if you really want to shift this dynamic, if the women stand up, the men have nowhere else to look but up with them. So they have no other honorable peasants. Yep. They have to stand up and rise to the occasion. But as long as you got the women, like how you and Toniel are pushing your narrative and out here doing your thing, guess what? Unfortunately, that same dude will meet Toniel in church. He'll say she's cute, try to pull up on her, but the minute she say, I'm taking a stand for God. Okay, sweetie, well, you know what? I still want to see. I'll talk to you next week. Guess what? Your sister outside going to give him everything you said no to. That's the reality.
See, and
where we are today.
That's what I was about to say, Charles.
Yeah. That's why it makes it hard for That's what makes it hard for the woman that, like you're saying, that knows her worth, trying to do all these things, and she feels like, look, why am I still getting the bottom of the barrel, and I'm really, really out here doing me? I'm doing this thing right. It's because it's this chain reaction. It's like you're trying to do this, but the sisters over here are allowing that. So there's no balance in the middle, and it's offset. And so
that's why I said what I said. I understand what Robert's saying, and I definitely understand what you're saying, which still goes back to personal responsibility. I say this all the time. You know, with me dealing with teenagers all the time, when I have a class full of teenagers, I can't tell them, you know what, it's the boys, it's the girls. You know what I tell them? When we stand before our Creator, we're not standing with a group, we're standing alone.
Right.
And so we have to account for what we've done, how we've lived, and the things that we've done in our humanity. We don't have somebody as an advocate to stand there and say, well, you know what? You know, well, P. Coffee, you know, the reason why she did that, God don't want to hear that. So we need to take responsibility for our behavior. And I understand the dynamic of what you're saying and this, that, and the other. But, you know, it's been going on a long time where we still, nobody's saying, you know what, it's me. I need to get myself right.
We all know this.
Right.
Like I said, but if we continue, I mean, we all know, but let's just be straight. If there are no requirements, there is no push to change. Yeah. We only move. Let's just be straight. We're not putting the blame on women or nothing like that, but let's just be straight. Men move by requirement. we move by respect. Mm-hmm. We don't see it, we're going to take our natural posture of being lazy and sitting back and collecting the land. That's what we're going to do. That's just the raw truth.
So what happened to the men that were leading y'all then? Where's the men where's the men in you all's lives that lead you all, that show you guys how to be honorable and men of integrity? Where are they at?
Robert just told you. It's not that we haven't seen it. The point is, it's not being required
you
today.
You can get away with it.
Yeah, that's it.
It's just like...
That's it. Go ahead, Tonya.
It's just like this. I'm sorry, Charles. It's like this because I agree wholeheartedly. Because here's to your point, Coffee. I don't think anybody is disagreeing with the fact that it takes accountability. But what the point is that there needs to be an enforced standard. And the fact of the matter is that the standards have gotten so low now. Like, it used to be a point where we say raise the bar, right?
Right.
Like, the bar, there is no bar. It's not even at the bar that I've been lowered. It is no bar anymore. And it goes to what Robert and Charles are saying. It's like, okay, if I'm being accountable, and so if somebody try to step to me and I'm like, okay, I'm in a relationship, so no, okay, and so that person may say, well, I'm gonna keep on trying or whatever the case may be. Or let's say if I put out there, no, you got to come to me like this. The problem is that you got 15 other people that don't have that same standard. That's what the problem is. For me, I might say that you need to have a full-time job, but somebody else might be like, oh, I'm good with somebody with a part-time job. Somebody else might be like, I'm good with somebody that work a temp agency. Somebody else might say, well, as long as I just got somebody in the house with me, they ain't gotta work. So all you gotta do now is find somebody that's holding out the standard that you're willing to meet. That's what the problem is. It's not about the, because what you're saying is in the ideal world, right? Like, where we all just have all of these wonderful standards. Because I think, like, when you get to where you want to be in a serious relationship with somebody, you think about that. But a lot of people are not looking for serious relationships. They're just looking to be able to have a field to play in. And so if I got all of these different options, again, we say, if I got all these different options, I'm not trying to get married. I ain't trying to be serious. And I got all of these people that'll let me hop in this bed, that bed, the other bed. You don't care that I just got out of her bed and I'm finna go to somebody's bed. Then why do I have to? Serious. I'm not trying to.
So let me ask you a question, Bruce. So based on what everyone has said thus far, where is it leaving the person with the standards that's living, you know, their lives in an exemplary manner to where they are doing the queenship, if you will, and they're not living beneath their privileges and they're abiding by a moral and ethic standard? Where does that leave that person? Where does that leave that woman at?
It leaves that woman on an island.
Pretty much.
If, how can I put it? I'm not saying that a woman should not live by those standards. Yes, she should.
Mm-hmm.
She should elevate the game because the game has dropped that low. But she's going to have to be prepared mentally and spiritually to be alone for quite some time. I'm pausing again.
Pretty much.
Well, Bruce, I'm going to offer a word of encouragement to my sister Tony. All right. Here's the thing. This is the bottom line. I am of the belief, as said in the word, Jesus Christ is the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. So his word is his word. The test is, this stuff that's happening is not by happenstance, all of this, you know, dropping of standards and all this thing. The test is for you, and I'm not talking to you, Tony, but it's saying to you, the test is for you to not be distracted by it and not feel like because you aren't compromising that you aren't winning. And so the more you do stand while the losing is taking place, the more God sees the favor on you to deliver what you need to your life. So my point is, regardless of all this crazy stuff, there's still a ram in the bush for that woman. You just have to stand to receive it. But if you compromise like the rest, you look just like a peasant, like Robert said. But if you stand out, regardless, and like Bruce said, it's going to take some faith because a lot of sisters, even in the church, is dropping like it's hot. So it's tough today. but it can be accomplished if you set yourself apart. It can happen.
I'm going to go to the comments, y'all. I'm going to go to the comments. Kimberly Aviva says, I don't care what the other woman will let you do. The standard I have is what is required. If a man wants to leave me because it's easier, let him go. He isn't for me. Marva said, now that's the truth. Alice says, it's how they were raised, what they will accept in life. Crystal said, an island alone in this culture. And then Carrie says, right to Bruce. I can't see the rest of them because there's so many coming in. But you know, this right here, it's disheartening at best if a woman really wants to be wed and she wants to have a healthy, long-term, committed relationship. It sounds so disheartening. And I see more often than not now that this is where a lot of this independent era has come in, to where a lot of women are like, you know what, I just don't even need a man anymore. And because there is it's so diluted as far as how we're carrying ourselves as a nation in totality, that we're carrying ourselves in such a diluted stance that no one even knows who has a standard or not. It's so bad that I'm gonna tell you guys an interesting story. This never happened to me until this year. I was going to meet a customer. I met the guy and I was standing there conversing with him. So I said, well, I tell you what, let me go in my office and set an appointment. We can set an appointment for us to connect and I can go over all of your risk management things and get you set up for your life insurance. And so the guy was like, okay, cool. So the way that I do it, I take another agent with me, because you got to be real wise when you're in sales and you're in this particular industry. So I take somebody else with me and we usually meet at Starbucks or some kind of public place to get everything executed with these clients. Well, the guy sends me a message and he says, hey, change of plans. Can you meet me this evening? Now, his appointment was like on a Thursday, on a Wednesday, right? So I said, so what is the challenge with the scheduling? Because we already have clients already set. So, well, you can just come over and we can watch a movie and have a couple of drinks and just talk about it from there.
No.
When I tell y'all, I am getting ready to be 44. That has never in my life happened to me. Never. I've heard women say it, and that's the first time I was freaked out, because I was like, did I send him a vibe or something? And it was interesting because the other agent that was with me, she said, she said, you're just getting into this industry, but she said it happens all the time that guys don't even know who is who, because just because you suited and booted doesn't mean you sassy and classy, is what she said. Like a lot of women suited and booted are doing the same thing as a chick. She was like, they literally cannot tell who's who anymore. And I was like, that is horrible.
Go ahead, Bruce. I know usually I do a little bit more talking, but we are in a system, y'all. I have to go there. We are in a system in which our culture is being handed to us.
The narrative.
The narrative is being handed to us with these reality shows and so on and so forth to tell us what Black culture is. We have no base for anything. We have no political base. Y'all understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I got it.
As Black people, we don't have a base for anything.
Right.
So foolishness has now become the culture.
Yeah.
Culture affects relationships.
Right.
Culture affects how we view each other. So when you talk about, when we started out talking about weaves and stuff, and Charles hit it like on the dot when you said the assembly line. Mm-hmm. Everybody looks the same.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, like with the culture being foolish and everybody looking the same, the only thing there is to do is meet somebody, play the game, and have sex.
And go to the next.
And go to the next.
Next.
Now, church is a very important dynamic. We all born again.
Yeah.
You know, we see it in a particular way. But even in the church now, the church is not evolving with the times. Mm-hmm. Not to take on the culture. No. Not that. Not taking on the culture, but it's not, excuse me, it's not combating the times that we are in. Mm-hmm. So the church done fell off. That's why Charles was saying what he was saying about the men of God. Mm-hmm. I care about no men of God these days.
Right.
Because the men of God ain't writing the book. After Martin Luther King, the men of God ain't standing up on any particular issues that affect us politically, socially, economically, the nine areas of activity. So it leads us to do nothing but play. You know what I'm saying? We have to, and I know, you know, I say it so much, y'all. I know people get tired of me saying it, but it's the matrix. It's the system. It's white supremacy.
Right.
It affects us and how we deal with one another. To the point now that when you look on the assembly line at the sisters, Lord have mercy, with hair hanging all the way down their butt, who are you looking like? It's not your hair. It's not you. It's not complicated. It's simple. This is not you. This is not who you are. And we have got so caught up in that we are forgetting the basic fact that marriage is for healing. Marriage is for healing. I have a child in me that's not healed yet. My wife is going to assist God.
Wow. And he'll heal me. That's deep.
Mm-hmm. And vice versa.
Right.
I'm the father.
So, So, are you finished, Bruce?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. So, I told Carver we're gonna try to stay in a spirit of excellence in our timing tonight. So we're gonna try to shift the thing in, and we're gonna do what we do in terms of how we, you know, we go and we say our things and we go from there. I have one confession I'll say to y'all, because each time I hear Bruce talk, it reminds me of something I said, and nobody knows this. I'm gonna tell all y'all this tonight. One time not too long ago, I was at this I went to this little place I like to have, this breakfast that I like. And so I went there, when I went to work, I stopped over there and I sat there this time to get me something to eat. I saw this lady that was my waiter. And she kept coming back and forth. And all I saw in my head was the assembly line, right? Cause it just looked, I mean, the whole thing, there was like a part over here, they had the whole thing. And I was just like, but the thing is, she wasn't an ugly woman. She was an attractive girl. She just overly adorned herself. That's so near, you get the spiritual word, right? But no, she was over the top. And so I think I was mean when she asked me a question. I said something that probably was really out of my character. But then when it was over with, she was crying. I'll tell you what I said to her. She said, so how are you on this great morning? I said, I'm fine. I said, but I feel cold now. She said, why? I said, because them big fan eyelashes of yours is giving me a cold. Because her eyelashes are like this, literally big, like this. No, listen, let me tell you. And she said, she looked at me, and I said, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to say that. This came out of my mind. I was thinking it, but I didn't mean to say it. So then she said, well, that was mean. I said, you know what? I didn't mean for it to be mean, but I said, I'm going to be honest with you. I said, I don't know what your deal is, but you don't have to overmake yourself. I said, just be, you're a young girl. I said, try being regular. And if the guys don't like you, then they ain't the dudes for you. But I said, all of that, it just tells me I see a gurney, I see band-aids, stitches on the inside of you that you just really messed up. And you feel like you need to dress like this to impress guys. I said, if you got it naturally, you don't need nothing else augmented. Take what you got and just go with that. And so she paused, she cried, and she put her plate down. She said, can I have a hug? And she said, I appreciate that. Thank you. She said, I'm going to take it off today. So, you know, the point I was just saying that to say, you know, sometimes it gets sickening when I see it, because I'd be like, what are we really trying to accomplish with all of this? Like, we got to get internally well first before you can present yourself to somebody else. And we got grown people and grown women doing this. This girl could have been no more than 19, 20, but we got grown women, 50s, 60s, and going doing the same thing today. So, you know, we got to kind of fix it so we can get back to normalcy. I didn't mean to go on a tangent, but anyway, okay, so Toneel, we'll let you do your spin and bring it on into the depot.
Lord, Toneel, go ahead and go ahead and pray for him while you're talking, Toneel. Lord have mercy.
Yeah, after that, I gotta come three after Hail that. Marys. I mean,
you need to go do three Hail Marys.
I'm trying to tell you, do it. No, okay. I gotta come after that. No, but look, okay, so we're talking about whether or not people want you for you or for what you have.
Correct.
And
correct.
I think it can really be summed up by knowing who you are and being content with what you have. So then that way you don't have to feel as though somebody else can be your enhancement, right? Because we've been talking about the men having enhancements and women having enhancements, but sometimes women want men or men want women so they can be their enhancements. And I think that when you are comfortable with who you are, you're comfortable in the skin you're in, then like Coffee, you were talking about, well, what does the woman who is, you know, is faithful and she's spiritual and all of this stuff, what does she do? She waits. What does a man do? They wait. And it's always easier said than done. But I think one of the reasons why we're looking so hard for somebody to complete us is because we feel like it's something wrong with us, where we need another person, a better, you know, another part to make us whole. But I think honestly that if you don't look at somebody else as enhancing you and you just put in that energy to making yourself be what you need to be, you'll be okay whether or not somebody else comes along or not.
Right, absolutely. That's good stuff.
I do like Bruce. Bruce, can I take it? Pause.
Yeah.
Pause.
I like it.
I ain't here, Chuck.
I was saying, go.
Okay, here it is. First thing I want to go on what Coffee said. What should you do? Not her, but the women that Coffee talking about, what you should do.
What?
Start using your eyes as protection and start seeing with your mind. Mm. In other words, ladies, what you're going to have to do, you done changed. You done went into isolation. You done came out. You have become this new woman. But what you're going to have to stop doing is seeing the old you and the old men that's in your life. Because a lot of times, the man that is for you, he's there. But you still have the vision or the memory of, you haven't divorced, you hadn't let that memory go. You still holding on to these men. I'm a new woman. I'm not the same. I'm not the same woman back in the day. I'm not the woman of convenience. So I'm going to have to start looking. I'm going to have to start paying attention with my mind instead of my eyes. Does he look good? Yeah, that's my preference. Mm. But can he enhance my happy?
Wow.
You see, we like our preference, but can your preference enhance your happy? Because sometimes you need to get with your kind. We want our type.
Yeah.
We need our kind. And a lot of times, we don't have to get our kind. We got to accept, like I said, who I am. People have asked me, Robert, why are you single? My mouth. Mm. That's why I'm single, because I'm unusual.
Right.
I'm not the copy.
I'm not the thug.
I come at the projects, but I'm not going into my 50s still trying to be a thug. I'm not still trying to play the player. I am who I am.
Right.
And whatever the voice I have will attract the one to me. My enough is enough. So ladies, understand, you must really stop using it as a catchphrase. You are the most valuable resource that I got.
Right.
You need to repackage what you are.
Right.
Ladies, repackage it. Because I am looking. I have repackaged. I'm a different package.
Wow.
I'm a different package. But if I keep seeing the same package, I ignore you. I hear caution. I'm not for sure. Well, baby, I'm going to go around you. You're not ready yet. Move. You still talking about this new woman? Get out the way. Let me keep going. Pause.
Wow.
All right. We taking it.
So Toniel and Robert both kind of confirm one another, but our good friend, I know Bruce, you know Jay Thomas, right? So Jay posted something earlier today that I thought was interesting. He posted, he said, when it comes to a relationship, are you truly wanting happiness or searching for preferences?
Yeah,
preferences. I thought that was profound because that's really what you guys were saying. Yeah, nowadays, people are busy looking. I'm tired of being alone. No, you're not really tired because you're still into the preference. If you really are tired of being alone, you'd be searching for hearts, not preference. So that's what we do. So go ahead, Bruce.
That's good.
I would say this. We have to get back to realizing that we are in a system that does not like us.
Mm.
The system that is anti-Black does not want the Black family together.
Mm.
When we approach our dynamics from that understanding, then men will start coming to women with a vision. We've just totally gotten away from visions now.
Yes, yeah, okay.
I'm gonna start a business. I'm gonna do this. I want to do that.
Yeah.
And I need your help.
Mm-hmm.
Without a vision, the people are gonna
perish.
They're gonna perish because there's nothing else to work for. Having sex, going to the movies, concerts, and dinner. That's not gonna make a relationship.
Mm.
Having a purpose does.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Having a purpose makes a relationship. We are working towards something together. Mm-hmm. Having a vision, having a purpose keeps me away from certain people, keeps me away from doing certain things. It always keeps me in a framework of protection to the point where it's me and you against the world, baby, just us.
Mm-hmm.
Me and you against the world.
Wow, that's good stuff.
Wow. Oh, get back to having a vision.
That's it.
That's super good. And that man. Mm, that's deep. That's good. Well, you guys, I got some good news and some good news. This is the last show for this year. I am in the middle of writing a book, and I've been invited to like 4 engagements, and I can't do it all, so I have to slow down and kind of get focused. And so I have thoroughly enjoyed doing this show for this past year, but I can't do it anymore, so I'm going to have to wait, revamp, regroup. Mr. Dixon is helping me to identify some other things that I can do in the interim to keep you guys engaged and plugged in so we don't lose our family. We built this family up, and we definitely don't want to not have the family because one of the family members has another assignment. But I have to be about my father's business while it's called day. And so I got to get this stuff done. And, I've been commissioned to go, so I got to go do it. I will be in Atlanta October the 5th speaking. I hope you guys are able to come. You'll see on my page I'll be posting. And also, I'm writing a book, and I will have that out in February. And this is an exciting time. I know Mr. Dixon is working on several projects, so it's a lot going on that we're working on behind the scenes. Nonetheless, we'll still be doing some lives from time to time and doing a variation of different things. We got some new branding projects coming out. It's a lot going on. So fortunately, when you start having babies, they start to multiply real, real quick. And so I had been standing on the word in the book of Amos said the stuff was happening so fast your head would swim. I mean, like literally my head was swimming, like, wait a minute, hold on. But, you know, it's a blessing. It really is. And I'm grateful. And I love each and every one of you guys. Mr. Dixon, we honor you. We certainly appreciate you, sir.
You have missed. Thank you very much.
No days at all on the work. And we still owe you 5 checks from the last few times. But
yeah, because a couple of them bounced. But go ahead. That's all right.
It's in the mail.
We can do the barter system.
Right. I know, right? But you guys, awesome. I mean, like, this has been an awesome opportunity. I mean, like, all this marketing stuff, I did my own book cover and all that. I didn't know how to do none of that until Mr. Dixon helped me. I mean, I didn't even know it was in me. So it's amazing how God brings people into your life to help bring you to pass. You the baby. You don't even know you the baby. You think you the Isaac. You don't even know you're Isaac. So, I mean, just awesome. And Bruce is working on some projects. And I know Robert Lee is doing some things. And Toniel always doing something. She don't ever slow down. So, you know, I just appreciate you guys so, so, so much. So, like I said, we'll be in the wind. We'll catch y'all. We definitely will be doing some things, most definitely. We're not going to just let the ship die because we have to do some transitions. But we love y'all so much. The audience, you guys are phenomenal. Mr. Dixon, you want to say anything, sir, before we shut
down? Yeah, I was going to say, real on the back of that, Sir Robert, we definitely, Bruce and I are going to be calling on you when we do our random men talks online,
yes,
different things.
Definitely.
So we're going to engraft you into the community, just, you know. And Toniel, you know, as we have random things, even sometimes, like there's going to be sometimes this year on my show, Unique Perspectives, where I may do some blue jean stuff like this. I know you're in Illinois too. You can come on through, but in times where you're busy and stuff, we can get you in there. You know, you can lay it out there to the sisters. You know, we always looking
absolutely
for that strong.
Absolutely.
But, and so all of this will be ghosts. We're just gonna be flavoring it up a little bit different. We're not gonna be ghosts. Mr. Dixon and I, we're gonna do some lives too. Like when we first started the ship out, we're going to be doing some lives on some different topics at various times. So we're going to keep the ball moving. It's just going to be moving in a different direction. So y'all just flow with us and roll with
different
us.
Pace.
Yeah. But no, I appreciate this. I appreciate this this format because, number one, I like that it is it's up close and personal. It's kind of like in your face. So it gives you a chance to kind of get to know people more personally than you would come afar. So I appreciate this. I enjoyed it. You know, last week I got served some papers, the protective order. But no, I'm just joking. Anyway, but no, anyway. No, just so real. No, so listen.
You need to get off.
May the Lord watch.
No, for real. Seriously. But at the end of the day, I thought this was a good platform. And I told P. Coffee, I said any kind of practice and exposure for yourself. It's good. I remember I told her one time before, she was nervous starting this off like I was when I started my show. And so I quickly looked to try to find people to kind of flank you so you don't have to be so exposed. But I told her, I remember telling her one day, I said, you'll feel comfortable once you, I think I told you about an interview show where I interviewed you.
Yeah.
I said, if you do the show, give people who you are, then from that point on, you'll be able to fly on your own. And so that's what she's doing now. So that's good.
Yeah, so that's awesome. So you guys definitely tune in to the conversation room. Mr. Dixon's going to be changing that up. He has a couple of other projects that he's working on that he's been working on in the wind for a while now. So he's going to be manifesting those coming up as well. So definitely be on the lookout. Stay on our pages. We got a lot going on. Unique Perspectives Love Talk Radio has a page. I have a page called Coffee's Corner. So you guys go like, share our pages. There's a lot of information that we filter out on a regular basis to stay connected to you guys. So we love y'all. Thank you so much for tuning in.
Yes.
We'll see you guys in the wind, and we'll definitely be hooking y'all up. Bruce, thank
congrats
you.
To
Robert,
you.
Thank
yeah, all
you.
Of y'all.
Neil, thank you. Thank y'all so much.
We stay connected. You stay connected.
We will definitely be connected. Absolutely. We ain't going nowhere. We just taking the boat in another direction, y'all. That's all.
Appreciate
y'all so much.
Good stuff.
All right.
Peace out.
Have an incredible night.
Good night.
Night.